Stop me if you've heard this before. Of course, you can't stop me because I'm sitting in my library making this recording. And it's asynchronous. By the time you hear it, I will not be sitting here anymore. So there are three global systems and two local systems. You can probably almost sing along with me now. Here's what they are. The global pressure belts, the global surface winds, the global upper air currents, also known as the jet stream. Very good. And then the local pressure systems and the local wind systems. Okay. There are three types of local wind systems. Here's who they are. The monsoon winds, very famous set of winds. The onshore-offshore winds or onshore-offshore breezes, also known as the sea breeze, land breeze, and the valley breeze, mountain breezes. This first video on local winds is going to be about the monsoons. The next video will be about the other two. Monsoon winds in Asia, especially, are one of the most famous wind systems on Earth and very, very important and consequential. A monsoon wind of any type, and I will tell you, we get monsoonal flows in California during the summer sometimes. And they happen also in Arizona as well. But I'm really going to focus on Asia because that's the big one, the famous one. A monsoon wind is a wind that reverses its direction between the seasons. Now, by the seasons, I mean really summer and winter, not all four seasons. And they're the result of changing high and low pressure systems. So a monsoon wind is a wind that reverses its direction between the seasons, and it's the result of changing high and low pressure systems, alternating high and low pressure systems between the seasons. Four things bring about the monsoons. Here's what they are. Number one, land masses heat up faster and cool off faster than water bodies. This is basically the continental versus maritime influence, right? Remember that from the first section? Number two, warm air rises and cold air subsides. Number three, air, do you remember this part? Acts like a sponge. When it's given the opportunity to absorb water, the air will absorb water. And number four, remember this? The warmer the air, the more water it can hold. See, we're connecting dots here. I give you some principles, then we operate with them over time and put the entire picture together. Take a look at these two maps. On the left-hand side, we have the winter monsoon in Asia, and on the right-hand side, we have the summer monsoon in Asia. Let's start with the winter monsoon. Asia, as I told you before in the previous video, is the largest continent on Earth. During the winter, it gets exceptionally cold. That cold air subsides. Subsiding air creates high pressure. And in fact, you even know the name of that high pressure system that is established during the winter months over Asia. It's called the, some people would say the, Siberian High. Excellent. And notice what happens. With high pressure, the air descends and diverges. This pushes the air out offshore. So the air is starting on the land and moving offshore. Remember, the air acts like a sponge, but over the top of the land, it's not going to be absorbing that much water. So this is the dry season for Asia. Now, if you look at the right-hand side, you can see the L's, which represent low pressure. Because what's going to happen during the summer months in Asia is it begins to get very hot. It's not untypical that in India during the summer, you will routinely get temperatures above 100, even to 110 and 115, occasionally 120 degrees. And in central China, in Xi'an, in Xinjiang, places like that, you can also get temperatures of 100, 110. Hot air rises. Rising air creates low pressure. Therefore, over Central Asia during the summer, large low pressure systems are established. With low pressure, the air converges and rises. As the air converges towards the low pressure systems, look at where the air is coming in from. The oceans. And at those latitudes, the Indian Ocean and the Pacific Ocean are tropical oceans. They're hot, which means you have hot air flowing in towards the continent. But wait, there's more. Now, how much would you pay? Remember, the air acts like a sponge, which means the air is going to absorb water. And because the air is hot, it absorbs a lot of water. And when the summer monsoon rolls in, it starts to rain. When it rains during the summer monsoons in Asia, if you've never been there for that and you've only been in California, it rains unlike anything you have ever seen. In California, we can almost dodge raindrops as they come down. When it starts to rain during the summer monsoons in Asia, this is no kidding, I've been in them. What it's like is this. You step outside into those rains when they're really pouring. Stand out there for 5 seconds, step back into your house, and you are as wet as if you just jumped into a swimming pool. But of course, they're critical, aren't they, for the function of life there? Because this is where the largest population on Earth is at. China has 1.4 billion people. India has 1.3 billion people. Indonesia has 300 million people. Bangladesh, that's as big as Wisconsin. Wisconsin has 5 million people. Bangladesh has 180 million people in it. Pakistan has well over 200 million people. And what do most people in Asia eat every day of their lives? Rice. How do you grow rice? In a flooded field. And no surprise, rice was first domesticated in Southeast Asia. So they can basically set their watch by when the monsoons begin to happen during the summer. They are critically important to the rhythm of life there.